Them all over the city, from the arts club to breweries museums, to churches, to the planetarium, and beyond. It goes without saying that this group is tightly woven into the fabric of Chicago and our hearts.
Dang.
And, wow, okay, all right, I didn't know that was coming up today, cool. So, without further ado, please, round of applause for the Spektral Quartet.
Told everybody that there's like a scary clown parade happening. I'm not sure how we're supposed to follow that exactly. We are the Spektral Quartet, plus one right now on stage. So please let me introduce Theo Espy and Clara Lyon, violins. This is Russ Rowland on cello. My name is Doyle Armbrust. And we are joined today by a number of friends. The one we have on stage with us right now is Evan Premo, the composer of the first piece that you're going to hear. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a second. But first of all, you had something slightly out of the ordinary on your chair when you got in here. I'm sure maybe a couple of you reflexively went to put a check in there. We are not asking you for money. You should have a, unless you want to, you should have a blank note card in a blank envelope, beautifully designed by our own Natalie Mills Boss Mossy, and a pen. And we're going to tell you a little bit more about that why, but maybe just keep it handy, especially after intermission. As we end, or we come to the conclusion of our cycle as an ensemble together, we've been thinking about this idea of cycles, and I was trying to think of one in my own life that is meaningful, and I think like probably the best one I can come up with.
Well, it's going to get weird now.
The one that I came up with is the first day of school photos. So every year we take this photo of my son in the very same spot, and he's holding a different stuffed animal each time. And it's sort of the same photo over and over again, and yet every year it's just a little bit different. I sort of like ascribe all of the things that have happened in the previous year onto that photo. It's really kind of an amazing way to like mark the passing of a year. In the case of this concert, we are going to be exploring cycles of different kinds, and as I say, as we come to the conclusion of our own cycle as a group, what we wanted to do was actually bring some of the people that mean the most to us into a room with you. So Evan and Mary run Scribe Mountain Music out in Vermont, and that has been a really special place for us. Probably shouldn't be saying this out loud, but not so long ago, we were grounded because of obvious reasons, and we decided to drive all the way to Vermont to make it on our promise to be at this festival, and I'm not really sure if we would do that for anybody else, frankly. The reason that we did it is that being with them is not just playing concerts. We share meals together, we go cross-country skiing together. It's just a really restorative time. And making music together has been a really important part of our life together. Another composer, the other composer, with another Chicago premiere on the concert, is Eliza Brown, who's been a dear friend since the very beginning. In fact, her first quartet was one of our earliest pieces of new music that we played. And here, as we're kind of coming full circle, we have the next installment, which just feels very special to be able to share that with you today. So we are going to start with Evan's brand new piece, My River Runs to Thee. And we're gonna get a chance to talk to Evan just after we play, but I just wanna set it up a little bit for you. The first thing that you should know is there's four movements, and there's going to be, is it five or four? No, I can't remember.
Four.
Four, right? Yeah, okay. Yep. There's a little bit of a pause after the first movement, but then the other movements will sort of happen very quickly, one after the other. And one thing that I really love about this piece is that I feel like it's been a while since I've played a piece of representational music. So in the same way of, you know, that we might look at a painting that's really meant to depict a very specific scene. That's what's happening in this piece. And Evan is tracing sort of the life cycle of water, right? So he's following the watershed. You're going to experience raindrops at the beginning, and then you're going to experience sort of like that growing momentum of the water picking up speed. And of course, at the end, you're going to encounter the water being washed out to sea. And definitely keep your ears open, especially at the very end of the piece, for something that might sound a little bit familiar to you. You will notice there will be somebody joining us on stage partway through the piece, so please nobody tackle them as they come up here. They're meant to be doing that. So without further ado, this is Evan Premo's My River Groans to Thee. Thank you.
Thank you. Places too. It's many cycles that kind of intersect, but in the form of this piece, it's really kind of starting up in the mountains or the hills with rainwater and then going underground and into the rivers and finally out into the big water, which Emily Dickinson calls sea, but I was also thinking about Great Lakes in a big way during that last movement with the stillness. And the other thing that Emily Dickinson brought to me, to this piece for me, was really making it a metaphor about life and our own lives and the cyclical nature of that, both in a biological and a spiritual sense, using the watershed as a metaphor for human life, which Emily Dickinson so beautifully does in that poem that you just heard. So.
Yeah, I think it's amazing too that like of all the elements, there's something about the way you illustrate it where in every part of the piece, it's so evocative of water, and also it can be so delicate, it can be so overwhelming, it can be very inevitable, and it can also feel very fragile. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like when you were writing, like, and you were kind of sort of working on the structure of the piece, that the cycles, how many times you repeat something felt inevitable or felt like organic, or was that something you had to puzzle through?
There was a lot of puzzling for sure. A lot of puzzling, but what I love about starting with a concept like that is that the form is right there. Like, the form of the piece was written before I even started trying to figure out the notes. And so I just had to follow that form. And that's also what I love about working with text, is there's so much form in the words. In this case, I didn't really use the form of the poem as much as, that last movement wasn't really a song as much as a kind of embodiment of the quintet, I think, but I think that's what I would say, is that the form of the watershed really dictated the form of the music and the number of cycles that was needed and in those close quarter note canons in the second movement, just following with my imagination that groundwater until it felt like it was ready to bubble up underneath the stream. Thank you.
Thank you, Evan. Everybody give Evan one more round.
Point of both ending and beginning fact finished the last movement of this piece during the week that I learned that this would be there that season as an ensemble. And so the very last movement of the piece that you're about to hear ends with the end of my first quartet. And I found myself called back to that piece as I was reflecting on the journey that we've had together and really wanting to allude to it as a sort of statement on ending and beginning, which the last text of this song, the last text of this song cycle, is also about how endings are also beginnings. And I think Evan put it really beautifully in I don't remember his exact words, but I think sort of like both a kind of material and spiritual sense. So this is a very sort of poignant moment for us as collaborators. But Doyle said something at the beginning of this show that really struck me, which was that, you know, we wanted to work together again and to share that with you. And so this is a really sort of poignant personal moment, I think, for all of us, certainly for me, returning to this collaboration for potentially the last time. But we can't have that moment without you here. Our work together has been putting art forward to share with an audience, and hearing what you think about it afterwards, and hearing what we think about it afterwards, and, you know, making us all a little bit less lonely in a crazy world. And so I'm really grateful for your presence here. And I think ultimately that is what this piece is about, is that the ways that people return to each other, that we return to ourselves, and that even when we experience endings, which can be fraught in many ways, that endings are often a point of return and of reminding us where we've come from and who we've been there with, and reflecting on that journey. So, yeah.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
problem was how to begin with the end. And then it turned out there were two ends. The end within the continuing, the continuing. And then again, you passed yourself coming and going, went through one loop and another. What was behind? Try through that us line until it was before you sprung.
Approaches. Was it my fault? I was too young for the war. A muddy rain spoils every picnic, but the fields are thirsty, the farmers are poor. My talent lies in kissing and pretending and climbing barefoot up a trellis. Dark. The neighbors are sharpening their pitchforks, though no one dares to tell us. In the park I found her note pinned to a linden, her hair ribbon snagged in a pine. All the world worries a lover when all the world seems like a sign. I crossed the cherries in my hat. She stowed her watercolors in
merry-go-round never stops. Cannons pounding in the distance, or was it thunder? Every ear felt the pop. As for us, we were always falling. Deeper than the tides in the moon. Deeper than the quarry in the well. And the shadows that hide at noon. All this frenzy, so the cocks are crowing. She led me to the table and a chair. The olive would glow to embers. She let me let down her hair. I kissed Izzy in his elbow, she sang, and the silky side of his thigh. I kissed his knees, I kissed.
Of weight,
shadows slip, shimmering black, and spin across the floor and turn back and make
I'm sure.
Thank you.
This next piece that we're going to play for you is just very near and dear to our hearts. It's somewhat fitting that this will be the last full quartet piece that we perform in Chicago for our beloved audience. Debussy, as many of you might know, was a bit of an iconoclast. He's someone who bucked the trends, who wanted to find a new way to express himself through music, and wanted to get out of old cycles, old habits of how music was told, how music was made. And he found his own way. And I think that's something that I'm very proud of that Spektral has done over the years, is we've tried to find our own way. We've tried to find a way of presenting music, of communicating music in ways that felt our own, in ways that felt true to ourselves. As has been mentioned tonight, we are coming up on the end of a cycle, the end of a life cycle. This is going to be our last season together. And as you might imagine, there's a lot that comes with that. There's grief. There's sadness. There is fear of the unknown. There's excitement for what's going to be new, what's next. There's pride in what we have done and what we have shared with people. This program, as we put it together, as we've talked about, it's about cycles. It's about those things we've already mentioned. And I think that one thing that the recognition of those cycles can bring us is perspective is an understanding of just a new way of looking at something that you thought you knew or you thought you understood. And so we'd like you all to participate with us tonight, if you'd like to and if you're willing, with the note cards that we left you at your seats. Sometime tonight, whether it's during our performance or afterwards, we'd love you to write a note to yourself. Something that you want to remember of this time, something that you're stuck on, a rut that you're stuck on, something you're afraid of, something you're happy for and want to remember in the future. Anything that comes to your mind that represents that feeling of being in a cycle of not knowing, of questioning, of anticipation, those things. Write it down, put it in the envelope, seal the envelope, write your address on the front of it. And then we're going to have you drop it in a box on your way out. Where's the box, Clara?
On the table.
On the merch table out here. Oh, after you buy your CD. Yes, yes. You can drop it. Drop it there in the table, and a year from now, we're going to send it to you. Okay? And that can be just a moment of perspective for you. Something that's private to yourself, something that you think you might want to gain a little perspective on a year from now. I promise I won't lose them. I'll put them in a safe spot. And seal them well. I promise I won't read them. I won't steam open them or anything like that. They're just for you. But we thought it was maybe a way for you all to experience what we're experiencing right now and be involved in that way. So thank you all for being here tonight. It's really meaningful to be able to do this. Thank you to the people who have made this happen. Jenna, especially, thank you so much. Yes. Thank you to our collaborators, Eliza and Evan and Mary. It's been just such a joy to work with you this year. Thank you so much. And thank you to all of you for being here, and we hope to have a chance to speak with you after the show. Join us for a reception afterwards and enjoy this Debussy.
Thank you. Thank you.